Look, thanks and thanks. It's great to have so many people here tonight. It's really terrific, actually, because this is not a topic that people like David and I are used to talking to large audiences about. So that's a good change. I want to kind of run through a bunch of big ideas, then we'll come to a discussion afterwards to kind of explore the synergies between what we've, at least three of us, are talking about. I want to start, though, with kind of picking up on David's point about the uncertainty in climate science and getting comfortable with the uncertainty in climate science. But kind of, as a movement, I think we've been running away from the uncertainty, saying, yes, it's clear, it's proven, it's absolute, the consensus is there. The reality is this is a hellishly complicated piece of science. And it's very difficult to say that we have a degree of certainty, and there are many, many deep uncertainties in the climate science. Now, many of us worry that they're all going the wrong way at the moment, which they are, but the point is to become accepting with the idea of uncertainty, because we are facing a very uncertain future and we're working in the context of very uncertain climate science. And I think that's really important, just to get that idea into our heads and be comfortable with that uncertainty, because that's the sort of situation that we're facing. The second key point I want to make is that there is absolutely no point, no need to make it more certain to know what to do. Right? That the level of uncertainty we have makes me very uncomfortable with our current direction. That we know what any kind of rational human civilization would do in response to what we now know today. And I think that's really important, because getting more certainty, getting more science, isn't going to change anything. That's not to say we shouldn't strive for that. We certainly should be striving for more research and getting deeper to understand the system and how it works better, but it won't change anything. Because fundamentally, what we know today is enough for the emergency response that David's talked about. Right? We have more than enough information based on what we knew, in fact, 10 years ago, I would argue 20 years ago, to respond in that way. And that's to me, a really critical idea that we haven't yet accepted in society, is that we don't need to know anything else about how the climate system works to know how to respond. That's not to say we shouldn't know more, but we don't need to know any more. You know, so in the sort of broad-based movement, we get quite attached to new ideas and new studies and new information, and we sort of yet again it reinforces the fact that we're right and we should respond in the following ways. And my point is, none of that is going to help, and none of it, frankly, has helped so far in terms of turning people to how we need to respond. I think that's unfortunately a reality we have to live with. More data hasn't been helping us to respond. Now, what we do know from today's science is that any logical, intelligent, rational risk assessment would say we should be having an emergency response to climate change today. And it is absolutely clear that we should be embarking upon that today. We should be organising a global mobilisation at a level of World War II and beyond, right? That we should be working out how to get back below 1 degree of warming above pre-industrial levels and then go down below that as fast as possible, because any rational society would do that. And that, of course, leads us to this really kind of interesting idea, is that, which I think is I'll come back to, is that why aren't we doing that? Given it's so rational, given it's so logical, why are we behaving so irrationally? I don't want to return to that as the main thrust in my comments. But first of all, let me just expand on this idea of which I think is a really crucial idea in the broad-based society as it wakes up to this issue, is that many people think there is a line you go past where it's too late, right? That there's sort of this magic binary question of it's okay, no, it's not, it's too late, right? And a car crash is like that. You get to a point where it's too late and you crash, right? This is not like that. Now, there may be points we can't recover from, but we don't know what they are, right? And there may be places we can go to yet that we can recover from. We don't know where those lines are, which is why the rational response is an emergency response, because of that level of uncertainty. But let's get out of our heads this idea that there is a binary question here of on time and too late, right? And there is a great piece I read some years ago from someone who talked about this in very emotional terms, saying there is no too late, because my kids will live in that too late world. Right? Therefore, their world will be around, and therefore everything we do to respond to this is absolutely crucial today, because whatever happens, there will be an earth. There will be people living on the earth, except for those who believe that we know and left, which I don't buy into. But whatever that point is, the point is that there is no point of too late, and that's, I think, a crucial idea in this area, because we have to acknowledge that there is going to be a future, and how we respond to that is a crucial crucially important question all the way through the process. Right, so where we get to and how we respond all the way from here on is really important, and therefore there is no too late. There is no point at which it's justified to give up. There is no point when despair can overtake us, because we can't afford to have that response. The reason I emphasise that for the kind of movement, if you like, in this area, is that the rest of the world hasn't woken up yet. And when they do wake up, they are going to shit themselves. Because this is really scary stuff. Right? And when you acknowledge that, and when you internalise the scale of the threat, it is very scary, and therefore denial is a common response, a natural response, frankly, to overwhelming grief. Right? And therefore denial is getting stronger. The worse the situation gets, the worse denial gets, but when it breaks through, therefore it becomes overwhelming. That is a really crucial point in the development of the ideas in this area, because as we get to that point and people go into a panic response, it's too late, I'm going to go away and hide, or live on farms in Tasmania like me, what a funny coincidence, is that is a dangerous point in terms of the mentality of society at large. If we don't believe it's possible to succeed, right, then we go into a spiral of fear and loathing about what's possible, and we end up going to a very bad place as a society. That's a very dangerous place to go to. So we can't go there as a movement. So let's just think that through for a few minutes and say, is it possible, therefore, to fix this still? Can we actually fix climate change? And I think on any kind of rational risk analysis, you would say, yeah, we can actually. We still can. We still will be able to for quite a while, actually. It just gets uglier and uglier in terms of the economic consequences of doing so. But can you do it? Absolutely. Can we eliminate, for example, fossil fuels from the economy in 20 years? Absolutely. And actually quite easily and quite cheaply. We could do it in 10 years. Right? And that's a really big idea. We could actually eliminate greenhouse gases emissions on a net basis from the economy inside a decade if we chose to do so. Now, would that be enough? I think it would get us towards the point where it would be enough to be on the right track. I actually don't think that would be enough, by the way, but that would get us to a place where we could start to think about managing the consequences. And that is, believe me, for any of the corporates I talk to, is so far beyond comprehension. Right? And in fact, for most of us in this room, it's beyond comprehension that we could do it. And so that's why I sat down with Jürgen Randers, who was one of the authors of the Club of Rome Limits to Growth Report in 1972, we sat down in 2009 and wrote what we called the 1 degree war plan. The lonely world of Phil Sutton and David Spratton and myself talking about these issues back then was to see, is it possible? What would that look like? And the answer is, not only is it possible, it's a whole lot cheaper proportionally than World War II was in terms of the economic cost. It is actually not very difficult to achieve in terms of the physical requirements of the things you have to do. It does require, obviously, massive economic change in society. It does require the elimination of a whole bunch of industries, right, and the creation of a bunch of new ones. It would, in that scale of time and response, and I want to come back to different ways of thinking about this as well, but it would require very heavy government intervention. Right, and it would require a forcing of market change at a scale that almost no one can comprehend today. Now, we went through the details of that, what would that look like. Of course, it requires rationing of energy, rationing of a variety of fossil fuels. It requires massive investment in renewables and rolling out of that of those technologies at very large scale very quickly. It requires a level of global mobilisation that's very hard to imagine today, but it doesn't require a consensus, by the way. There is no point in history where we've had a consensus of the world's governments to do anything. Even something that we broadly as a society, as in the elites of society, broadly agree upon, like free trade, right, as a good idea, as fundamentally probably a good thing to move towards, it's taken us 50 years to get towards some point of freer trade between nations with sanctions against some countries. It took, I think, 19 years of negotiations for China to enter the WTO. Right, so that's when everyone kind of agrees and thinks it's in their interest to do so. So the idea that we would suddenly have a global agreement to act on climate change by consensus, I think, has been one of the great cons of climate change history, is that we put it out there as the goal, knowing, as the people who wanted to avoid it knew, it would never happen. Therefore, it was a safe thing to support because it was impossible to achieve. That's really, again, a crucial idea, is you think about ideas like the 1 degree war plan. We don't rely upon that. You need kind of five countries to get to 65% of emissions, I think it was. If you bring in their friends and normal allies, you were kind of 75% in no time. And then you're kind of home and hosed. Australia's out there as a rogue nation with Iran being bombed by other people for being naughty. But by and large, most important countries are in there. But at that point, it's important to remember you don't need to have a global consensus to have that level of wartime mobilisation. You only need to have a coalition of the cooling, as we called it. A coalition of the cooling who decide it's in their interest to act. Right? And that idea, I think, is also, again, a crucially important one. If we don't need to have this fantasy of everyone agreeing, and they're not going to, even in the middle of a climate crisis that I see coming, they're not going to. But at that point, you don't need to have that to achieve that level of mobilisation, as we saw in World War II. Now, just a few comments about how do we imagine that? Because as we know today, nobody can imagine that, pretty much. Most of us can't imagine there being no fossil fuel industry inside 20 years. But that's what the science says we need to achieve. Right? So that's sort of, let alone the people who are investing in those industries imagining that, let alone those running it. So it's impossible for them to imagine because it's just not reasonable that they would imagine that, actually, in those companies. So we just shouldn't expect them to. Right? We didn't negotiate the end of landline telephones in Africa. It just happened. Right? We don't imagine those things inside those players in that part of the economy. They just get replaced, and that's how markets work, which I'll come back to. But let's just think about the level of frustration, because you may have noticed we're not responding with a wartime-like mobilisation in response to climate change. We're not having a rational response, which is sort of interesting, isn't it? I mean, it's like it's so clear, and it's so obvious once you get it, but we're just not seeing it as a society. So I think that's sort of worthy of a few comments. I'm currently reading yet another Churchill biography, who's one of my fascinations in life, because he went through this process, exactly the same process, basically, of very clear data, overwhelming scientific evidence, if you like, of the rational need to respond to the threat that Hitler posed in Europe. Can you imagine what it was like for him in 1936 and 1937, when it was so obvious that we needed to respond, when everyone was dismissing him as a lunatic? Right, as yesterday's man, washed out militarist, warmonger, right, half crazy, arguably mostly crazy, drunk, depressed, alcoholic, and was written off largely as a man whose time had passed, who was wrong about the science, as it was then, of the threat, right, was clearly, you know, not the right kind of response we needed to have, was clearly not going to be a successful politician again, and then became one of the great leaders of the world in history, a legend in terms of leadership, a legend in terms of response. Now, but imagine what it was like for him in before that. Now, he was in the wilderness, right? And he believed that he was right, that everyone else was wrong, right? And had this incredible confidence that he was right about that, but it was very, very difficult. He would have gone a little bit crazy in that process. Because normally when you think you're right and everyone else is crazy, that's not right. Normally, it's because you're a bit crazy. So it's actually very hard to maintain that position in that context. Good, well done, David. You're doing well. You appear to be mostly sane. So that is a really, really important idea, right? Because what happens in that example is that suddenly the world turned. Now, suddenly it woke up. Now, we can all argue about what the trigger was and whether it was caused by this or that. But the point is, this is what we always do. And I want to really get this point across very simply and very clearly. This is the way humans behave all the time. When we're faced with existential threats, when we're faced with overwhelming evidence, and we know that we need to act, because if we don't act, the consequences will be terrible, we don't do anything. We avoid it, we delay, and we put it off until the last possible moment. And then when there's no choice but to act quickly and urgently, we put it off for a bit longer. And then we panic and respond. Right? And that's how we tend to do most things. That's why so many people, after a heart attack, suddenly discover exercise and health. That's why so many companies, you know, go to almost the wall, then turn themselves around. That's why countries do that all the time. It was like the global financial crisis. Did we kind of invent the problem of there being too much credit at that time? No. Did we know it was coming? Yes. Did we wait until it was too late? Yes. Did we then respond? Yes. Right, so the point, well, good, we didn't respond enough in that. We'll come back to that later on, perhaps. But the point is that we'd always do this. Right, we did it in World War II, and yet when we did respond in World War II, which I still think is the best example of this, I mean, an absolutely phenomenal mobilisation occurred. We went, the US, for example, went from 1.6% of GDP, I think it was, being spent on military spending, from 1.6 to 35%, 36% in 4.5 years. I mean, a colossal economic mobilisation. Right? During a time, the GDP grew 75%. So just incomprehensible today. Now, we don't need to do anything like that on climate change to fix it. So fixing climate change in that sense is nowhere near as difficult as that was, and yet we managed to do that in a remarkably short turnaround. And at that time, it seemed impossible. As Mandela says, it always seems impossible until it's done. And in the case of World War II, if you think about what actually happened there, and you had to describe that beforehand, if you had to describe that level of economic mobilisation required to achieve that objective, everyone would say it's impossible. Everyone would say it can't be achieved, and yet it was achieved. And we look back on it with, obviously aware of the tragedy and the incredible suffering that went through that. We look back and say, yep, we had a problem. We put it off a bit too long. We responded, we fixed it, we moved on. Right? And so I think that's important, that historical context to paint this picture, because right today, this idea seems like an impossible thing to achieve. I want to close with a set of comments about a different way of seeing the world. I think it's important when you've been involved in these issues for a long time to always challenge your way of thinking. So I'm always challenging mine, because my basic view is that we're going to respond with a crisis. We're going to put it off until we have no choice but to respond. We're getting in a panic. We're then going to have heavy government response and involvement to force that change. And until then, nothing else much will happen in terms of the scale of change we need. I read a book recently by a fellow called Tony Sieber from Stanford University, who comes from a technology point of view. I'm not saying this is right, but I just think it's important to have a different set of thinking about these issues from time to time to challenge ourselves and the assumptions that we make. Now, what he argues, and what I'm seeing an increasingly large number of people arguing, is that fossil fuels are just a stupid idea, right? And they're just an inefficient way of making energy. They're inefficient way of running an economy, and therefore they'll become obsolete by virtue of technology in less than 20 years. Now, he argues that the combination of electric cars and solar, et cetera, is going to make the fossil fuel industry obsolete before 2030, that we're going to see a crash of those companies in that time frame, and that the market will kind of see this process unfold, not to fix, he's not focused on climate change, he's focusing on technology. But his argument is that just the power of technology and markets and change, driven by, yes, government policy driving that process, which is why it's happening, right, will then accelerate and take over the process and will wipe out those industries by itself. Now, that I read that some years ago when he first started talking about it, and I've argued this was going to happen, but for different reasons. And I look back on this and think, okay, well, I'm still deeply challenged by that view. And I have many people who think it's wrong, who are very smart people. But I just think we should raise the idea in our heads that this is actually going to happen under its own steam now. And that if we look around the coal industry today, we see, for example, measures like the Bloomberg Global Coal Index, which is measuring pure coal companies, has lost 2/3 of its value in the last 4 years. So if you're in the coal business, the carbon bubble has burst. Right now, 2/3 of the market cap of coal industry has gone in 3 or 4 years is an amazing outcome. Right, the pace of change in solar is phenomenal. Right, the arrival of electric cars. So I read a report recently from Allianz Bernstein, a big US investment company, who argued that the momentum behind electric cars and batteries and solar, and Giles Parkins writes about this on Renew Economy very well, argued that, and again, this is just like an idea to put out there, this major investment house said, look, solar is huge, it's going to take over the energy markets, it's irrelevant today because it's so small, so even phenomenal growth rates won't make much difference, but it's one to watch. And then they had this sort of casual throwaway line in their study, which said, look, and probably, I can imagine within a decade or so, energy price deflation caused by solar, right, affecting the global oil market. Now, that's a completely mind-boggling idea. Now, the assumption that we've all been making is energy prices get more and more expensive, that oil gets more and more expensive, that we're forced to change because it becomes too expensive. Their argument is, no, we'll change because it becomes cheaper to do the alternative. Right? And the reason oil prices will go down is because solar is cheaper than oil. Electric cars and batteries are cheaper than oil. Right? Now, that is an amazing conceptual idea. And the reason it's so important to get our heads around is because if that's right, then the coming kind of policy push towards this area becomes very interesting indeed. Because what it means is even if that stuff doesn't happen by itself, the potential for it to happen means that policymakers then become comfortable in driving that process. Right? And once they become comfortable driving the process, then of course they accelerate the process and they become part of the sort of momentum towards that outcome. And that to me is it's a very kind of dangerous idea for those of us who believe that government is the main driver of action in this area, but it's a really interesting idea to think that possibility is out there. Let me close with a quick comment about optimism. Is that, you know, there are no great social movements built on the idea that we think we're screwed and we'll have a go on the way down. Right? I mean, the ANC's whole thing was freedom in our lifetime. Right? Martin Luther King's thing was not, I have a nightmare. Right? It was, I have a dream. Right? There is nobody who succeeds in mobilising the broad public with the idea that we're screwed. Now, that is a really important idea for those of us who think that we're screwed, right? Because it means it's an incredibly unappealing idea. And so I kind of go back to my opening point, is that there is going to be a future, right? There is going to be a civilization of humans on the planet, right? And if you didn't think that, you wouldn't be here tonight, because why would you bother? Right? So you believe that, and therefore framing this movement, framing this idea in possibility, and pursuing this idea that we can actually achieve the transformation we need is a crucially strategic question for the whole climate change movement. Thank you.